She's only 12 years old, but racist abuse is already part of her daily life. When Marli from Weymouth revealed the extent of the discrimination she's already experienced as a mixed-race youngster, even her own mum was shocked. Now the pair are calling for more to be done in schools to teach young people about the impact of racism. They've been talking to our reporter, Matt Treacy.
One thing I tell myself every day is, Marli, you are strong, powerful, beautiful and talented in your own ways. And if anybody hates on that, then that's their problem. My name is Marli and I was born in Dorchester with a Belizean dad and a British mum. I'm half Black Caribbean and half British. This makes me mixed race. In my lifetime, I've experienced lots of racism.
Marley's got three brothers. All of them have grown up in Weymouth. All of them love football and all have experienced racism. So when the 12-year-old was given a school project about something she wanted to change in the world, Marli wrote about the discrimination she'd suffered.
I have been chased around a playground by someone making monkey noises and actions. People often touch my hair without asking, which is really annoying and can be uncomfortable. This just makes me feel that I am different to other people because of the way I look.
When I was pregnant with my children, I had no idea of the sort of life they would end up having to live. I had no idea. I was totally naive, totally oblivious for the things that I, as a white person growing up, take for granted. But hearing it in her own words, with no input from anyone else, just brought a lump to my throat, really.
Most people don't understand what it's like, and they think they might, but they really don't. Because, like, they see what it's like, but then they don't see the inside. Like, they see the outside, but they don't understand what it's really like to be out like me.
Marli's mum posted her homework on social media and has been overwhelmed by the response.
Stick up for what you believe.
The family now want to campaign to persuade the government to include more education about racism in the national curriculum.
Oh, good.
There needs to be more conversation between people, and people need to, like, also learn in schools what it's about, what's happened back in history, and why it can be not very nice sometimes.
People are so shocked by it. But I think that's a good thing, because people now hopefully will be a bit more aware that it is going on where we live.
You might think that you know and you might understand, but you don't, and it needs to be sorted.
People need to have that chat with their children, have that chat with your kids like I have to chat with my kids. They're no different. There's adults who are bringing up children who are just naive themselves and have no idea of the consequences of words and actions.
Very brave young girl there. Thank you to Marli and her mum Vicky for talking to us. Well, Louisa Adjua Parker is a poet, author and educator. Last year, she set up a project to highlight rural racism. I spoke to her a little earlier and started by asking her whether she was surprised by Marley's experience.
I wasn't surprised to hear Marley's story, because I've heard lots of these stories over the years, but I think it doesn't take away the shock, and I always feel shocked when I hear stories like this, unfortunately.
Now, even her mother had no idea of the prejudice that her children would face. How do you prepare children of mixed-race heritage for what they may have to face in future?
I think it's not just a case of preparing the children. Our parents can talk to their children about some of the issues. They can find out what challenges they might face. But I think it's also about, as a white parent, understanding that you may still have unconscious biases and beliefs that come from growing up in a white supremacist sort of society. And actually, you can think about, how can you become an ally? How can you become actively anti-racist and really work to support your children?
Now, could it be that some of what is construed as racism is actually curiosity? For example, if people aren't used to seeing other people from different backgrounds, they're naturally interested in them, and that can be misconstrued.
Well, I think there's a real fine line between what's curiosity and what is a sort of form of racism. And one of the things that people have been talking about a lot over the last year is microaggressions, and that's the more subtle forms of racism, such as comments or hair touching that we can experience. And often people don't intend to be racist at all. And I think that's one of the areas that we need to sort of talk about a bit more, really, because that can have big impact on children and young people and adults, you know, living with this on a daily basis.
There's been a lot of controversy this week about the England and Sussex cricketer Ollie Robinson, with his teenage tweet suggesting that perhaps youngsters don't fully understand the impact and the consequences of racism. So should more be done in schools?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, education is key, working with children from a very young age. But I think also it's about, education of the wider community, having these conversations, understanding that we're all in it together, and sort of trying to find a way that we can move forward in a positive way and become much more inclusive as a society.
I say, so if we're looking at it with a positive approach, how can you confront racism when you come across it?
Well, I think it depends who it is, really, because some of us are better placed than others to challenge it. And I think it's easier for somebody who doesn't have lived experience of racism to actually challenge it when they see it. Because if we, people of colour who speak out when it happens to us, often we can face sort of anger or denial or some kind of backlash. It doesn't always feel safe for us to do it. But I think people from the white community, if they want to do that, they can challenge it and wherever they see it, wherever that may be.
OK, Louisa, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.